Hello everyone, and welcome to Christchurch Purley Online. My name is Bejoy, or Bej for short, and it's so great to be with you today. I hope that you had a wonderful Easter weekend last week, and were able to enjoy the bank holiday, whatever it was that you were doing. I love Easter. It's such a big part of the Christian faith, and has had a huge impact on my own personal journey. And knowing that the hope of new life and forgiveness that rose with Jesus more than 2,000 years ago is still something that we can hold on to and hope for today, I don't know about you, but that just always blows my mind. As a church, we've been looking at Luke's Gospel. And today we're going to be looking at what happened after Easter on that road to Emmaus. Jesus' work didn't finish on the cross. And the story of the two disciples walking with him on the road to Emmaus shows us more of the adventure that Jesus continues to invite us into. So today we're going to be unpacking this, knowing that there is still work to be done post-Easter. We're going to be moving into a time of worship, but before we do that, I'd like to invite you to pray with us. Father, thank you that you love us so much that you sent Jesus to live with us, to teach us, to lead us, and to die for us. Thank you that you sent Jesus to rise with us, to inspire us, to empower us, and continue building your kingdom in your spirit. We want to say sorry for all of the times that we have messed up and have not listened to your call. And not listen to your will for us. Please encourage us to see and feel the power of your forgiveness in the image of the cross, so that we may know your victory over sin. And through accepting that forgiveness for ourselves, we pray that we will be transformed in your sight and know the promise of everlasting life into eternity. Thank you for loving us unconditionally. Amen.
Loving God, we give thanks for the life of Prince Philip, for the love he shared among us, and for his devotion to duty. After his long and full life of service to both Queen and country, we entrust him now to your love and mercy. Loving God, we ask that you will be especially close to the Queen and all members of the royal family at this time. Be with the family in their sorrow at the loss of a husband, father, grandfather, and great-grandfather. May they know the hope of your promises and the comfort of your love. Loving God, as we remember Prince Philip's vision and imagination, his interest in young people and his support for them, help us to be inspired with the same commitment to serve friend, neighbour, and stranger alike. Loving God, be with us as a nation and help us both together and in our own individual ways to show support to our Queen in this time of great sadness for her. We ask that she may be filled with strength to continue serving our country as she has for so many years. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. The reading today is taken from Luke chapter 24, beginning to read at verse 13. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself.' As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread."
Well, good morning, Christchurch. And before I start to talk this morning, just let's say a short prayer. Lord Jesus, may the words of my lips and the thoughts of all our hearts be always acceptable to you. Amen. Well, today we're going to continue looking at studying Luke's Gospel, and we've been looking at it over the last few months, and in particular those occasions that are not recorded in any of the other Gospels. And today we look at the passage after the resurrection, and this concerns two followers of Jesus who are not his disciples. And our theme today is burning hearts. So what happened during this walk that changed two disheartened followers into important witnesses of the resurrection of Jesus? Have you ever looked for something around your house, maybe your car keys or your glasses, only to discover after a long and frustrating search that they were right there in your hand or your pocket or even on your face. We have an uncanny ability to miss the obvious sometimes. And I would like to look at the journey of Cleopas and his companion this morning and reflect on how their despair and disappointment was changed to hope and elation into a burning heart. It's a very familiar story to us and follows on from the events of that first Easter morning. Some of those terrible deeds would certainly describe Cleopas and his companion as they walked along the road to Emmaus. They certainly would have felt disappointment, doubt, disillusionment, discourage and despair. Emmaus is a town about 7 miles west of Jerusalem, so they have a good couple of hours' walk in front of them. The festival of the Passover is open, and they leave the downhearted and afraid band of disciples, who are still afraid for their lives, over what had happened to Jesus on that Good Friday. Their initial high hopes as they entered Jerusalem had been cruelly dashed, and the master they had followed had been horribly put to death, a cruel and degrading death on a cross. And Jesus had been made a public spectacle. Their hopes had been dashed and their dream was over. They also left Jerusalem with confusion. They had heard the reports of the woman that Jesus' tomb was empty, but they did not have the knowledge to know what this meant. Cleopas and his friend were not among the close 12, but they were certainly close followers of Jesus and his band of disciples. And they sum up their feelings when they say, "We had hoped that we would be one who was going to set Israel free." Hope was an emotion that can take a lot of recovery if circumstances work against us, and can be a very fragile emotion when someone you love and care for is overtaken by serious illness, which goes on and on. Despair can set in, and it almost becomes impossible to hope for recovery. For non-believers, they even add to their despair that they have no hope for their eternal life. "We have hoped," Cleopas and his friend had said. They had high hopes for the future, but now those hopes are gone, and all we have left is disappointment. Can you identify with the feelings of those two disciples in any way? For each of us, the chance of feeling sad may be different, but it would be a rare person indeed who could claim that they were not affected by any of those D words, disappointment and doubt. The stranger they meet asks what they were discussing, and they pour out their story to someone they seem willing to listen. They tell the stranger all about their hopes and their disappointments, and the stranger provides a listening ear. We know the stranger was Jesus, but that time they didn't. As Cleopas and his friend talk about the cross and their despair and sorrow, Jesus reassured them and helped them. He pointed out what God says in the Bible. Luke tells us Jesus explained to them what was said about himself in all the scriptures, beginning with the book of Moses and the writings of all the prophets. Jesus must have given them the best ever lesson in the Old Testament, reminding them of how sin came into the world through the disobedience of Adam and Eve, and how the prophets foretold of a saviour who would be obedient even to the point of death. No doubt he would have referred to Isaiah's description of a suffering servant of God who was wounded for our transgressions. It's not that these men did not know their Bibles, but their understanding was clouded by the idea of a Messiah who would come in glory and power as a mighty political leader. The feelings of despondency and sorrow start to lift as their heart changed with the understanding of the stranger explained Jesus' death as a part of God's plan for salvation. So how can the events of this journey affect our lives? When doubt, depression and discouragement dominate our lives, Jesus walks with us as he walked with the two men on the road to Emmaus. He points out to God's words of promise in the Bible that tells us again he will stand by us through thick and thin, and he turns our despair into hope. I wonder if that's something like the shock of the two disciples felt when they finally realised who it was they'd been walking along the road to Emmaus. Why hadn't they recognised Jesus sooner? Why did it take them so long to catch on? Biblical commentators have come up with a number of interesting proposals to explain their difficulty. It was the blinding brightness of the sun in their eyes, or maybe Jesus looked strikingly different after his resurrection. I wonder if it was something as simple as the fact that they weren't expecting to see Jesus walking along beside them 3 days after his death. Because we're not expecting to see them in that context, it can take our brains a minute to catch up with our eyes. So I wonder how long would it take me to notice that someone I last saw in having died was sitting beside me on that bus or the train. Or maybe it wasn't that simple. The text also says that their eyes were kept from recognizing Jesus at first, and that later their eyes were opened. An extraordinary act of God could well be tucked behind that passive voice. That hidden agent who first keeps them from seeing and then allows them to see all. After all, how else could we explain Jesus' quick disappearing act as soon as the two disciples finally do recognize him? But whatever the reasons for their lack of recognition, visually speaking, there's also a deeper recognition issue at play. Notice how much Jesus makes of the lack of understanding demonstrated by Cleopas and his friend. He calls them foolish and speaks of their slowness to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Perhaps they'd misunderstood something fundamental about the nature and the role of their Messiah. They'd certainly have been in a good company if they found the news of the empty tomb hard to progress. Notice that a tension develops as they wander down the road, and it arises because, according to early verses in the chapter, the report of the women had not convinced the disciples. Of course, Luke's congregations, hearing Luke's story, no resurrection has taken place. They, and we, comprehend a good deal more about what was happening than do Cleopas and his companion. We want to tell them, climb up on the stage and whisper what we know to shout it, Christ is risen. He's standing right there behind you. But of course, the two disciples are as deaf to our cries as they are blind to the identity of their companion on the road. Until, and notice what it is finally prompting their understanding. When Jesus does something as ordinary as sitting down at a meal and breaking bread with them, then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. Sitting around a dinner table together, we've been in a very familiar setting for the two of them who encountered Jesus along that road. So I don't think it's all coincidental that it was there that they had their ha-ha moment. It may be that familiarity in this simple action that struck a chord deep within them and triggered recognition. What is it that triggers recognition in us, here and now? What is it that makes us aware of Christ's presence in this place? It doesn't need to be anything fancy or complicated. It can be the simplest things, a prayer, a favourite Bible verse, or a familiar song, a splash of water on someone's forehead, an ordinary looking loaf of bread, and a pitcher of wine sitting on a table. Remember that Jesus had already lectured at some length on the many references to him throughout the scriptures, and it wasn't that he hadn't presented the material, but the two disciples didn't actually recognize who he was and what he was saying until he sat down with them and broke bread at the table. An ordinary act to begin an ordinary meal in an ordinary house. Nothing fancy, just a simple meal. And it was then that they recognized their Lord. And although these two disciples didn't seem to have been with the 12 at the Last Supper, Luke certainly invites his readers to reflect on that and other important meal at this point in the story. The phrase, the breaking of the bread, becomes a catchword for the regular celebration of the Lord's Supper in the early church. And as Luke's gospel story continues in its sequel, the Acts of the Apostles. The good news in today's text is that in spite of their foolishness, their slowness of heart, and their mistaken expectations, the two disciples who walked with Jesus from Jerusalem to Emmaus finally were able to recognize him. Their eyes were opened, and Luke says their hearts burned within them. One preacher talks about how Jesus transformed these two disheartened people, turning weak hearts into burning hearts, ablaze with the good news of the gospel. And at the moment the stranger reveals who he was, he vanishes from their sight, but he is not gone. He's still visible to those who have the eyes of faith. But just a couple more observations about our passage this morning. First, this is one of the handful of stories we find at the end of the Gospels about the resurrected Christ having something to eat. And this is significant because it shows that after he had died, he came back in such a way that he was able to ingest food. And the Gospel authors wanted to make clear that the disciples hadn't seen a ghost. Jesus was back in the flesh. And later in the same chapter in Luke's Gospel, we find him eating a piece of broiled fish. In John, he cooks fish on the beach. And here in Emmaus, he sits down to dinner and breaks bread. That the disciples continue to have dinner with Jesus following his resurrection is not coincidental, but actually quite significant to the story and the evidence. And finally, I'm intrigued by the identity of the two disciples in our passage today. You may have been a little surprised that Jesus appears to a couple of second or third rate disciples here. The fact that only Cleopas is mentioned by name and that he's not identified anywhere else in the Gospels has puzzled readers for generations. Some of the more intriguing suggestions are that Luke himself was Cleopas's friend. Unfortunately, none of this can be proven from the text. But how fascinating that Jesus would appear for the first time after his resurrection, according to Luke anyway, not to the 12 disciples or even to the women who went to the tomb, but to two of his lesser known followers. For it reminds us that the way of the discipleship is open to each one of us. And it may be strange to you, but Christ will open your mind to understand his word. The word that is to be a light to your path, and his holy meal will sustain you on your journey. Why me, you may say? Well, Jesus isn't looking for a superman or woman. He's looking for an ordinary person, open-hearted men and women, to receive God's gifts of grace, forgiveness and love, and then to pass them on to others. We can all experience those times when we have the disappointment and doubts and discouragement in our lives. But let's remember, we are not walking alone. The unseen stranger, the risen Jesus, is walking with us. And may God grant to each of us, ordinary disciples, in some familiar moment, clarity of vision and the holy heart burn that comes from an encounter with the risen Lord in our lives. Amen.
Having heard God's word, we now affirm our faith in the words of the Creed. We say this together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
O Christ, we come into your presence, and how beautiful it is. There is no place so beautiful as the place where you are. An Easter song of praise from the Iona community. Christ, our life, you are alive in the beauty of the earth, in the rhythm of the seasons, in the mystery of time and space. Christ, our life, you are alive in the tenderness of touch, in the heartbeat of intimacy, in the insights of solitude. Christ, our life, you are alive in the creative possibility of the dullest conversation, the dreariest task, the most threatening event. Christ, our life, you are alive to offer recreation to every unhealed hurt, to every deadened place, to every damaged heart. You set before us a great choice. Therefore, we choose life. The dance of resurrection soars and surges through the whole creation. It sets gifts of bread and wine upon our table. This is grace. Dying, we live. So let us live. Alleluia. Lord, at this Easter time, we ask you to increase our faith, our hope, and our love. Give us the faith that overcomes the world and enables us to face both life and death, calm and unafraid. Give us the hope that looks beyond this mortal life and grasps hold of the things unseen and eternal. Give us the love that binds us more closely to one another and to you, our risen Lord, to whom be all glory and praise, dominion and power, now and forever. Amen. Father, we thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ to be the way, the truth, and the life. For the love which moved him to endure the cross for us and for all mankind. For the victory of his resurrection and the glory of his ascension. For the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the witness of the Church through many centuries. For the encouragement of our growing awareness that we are all one in Christ Jesus. For the blessings received in belonging to one another in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. For the privilege of being called to discipleship of Jesus Christ, to bear witness to his eternal presence and his saving power. Risen Lord, who on the first Easter day drew near to your two disciples on the Emmaus Road, and at evening stayed with them in their village home, be our unseen companion along the daily journey of our life. And at the ending of the day, come and live with us in our homes for your love's sake. May we each one of us have a burning heart in the same way that those disciples experienced on the Emmaus Road, so that we may joyfully and wholeheartedly use our lives and all that we have to make you known to others around us, through our words and lives, through our prayers and gifts, so that we might be true and faithful witnesses to you, our Lord, Master, and friend. May our words and actions be the message of hope and new life that is to be found in you. And bless us as we bring the gospel, the good news of Christ Jesus, to those who are in need of your salvation and your love. In Jesus' name, Amen. Lord, as we prepare for entering the next stage of the roadmap in the lowering of the lockdown restrictions, we thank you for your grace, mercy and loving kindness as you pour into broken bodies, minds and spirits the healing grace of your own blessing, and in a thousand, thousand ways show your care for what your hands have made. Continue, Lord, to stretch out your hand and set us on our feet again. Put strength into us and keep us safe under your powerful protection. And may we constantly know and experience your peace and assurance of good hope, which passes all our understanding. As we pray for all who suffer through sickness of body or mind, through fear or depression, through loneliness or bereavement, we ask that according to your will, they may be healed and comforted in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and risen Saviour. Amen. And now to him who is able to keep us from falling and lift us from the dark valley of despair to the bright mountain of hope, from the midnight of desperation to the daybreak of joy. To him be power and authority for ever and ever. Amen. And may we go forth into the world in peace, being of good courage, holding fast that which is good, rendering to no man evil for evil, strengthening the faint-hearted, supporting the weak, helping the afflicted, honouring all people, loving and serving the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us and remain with us this day and all days. Amen.
We'll be using the Eucharistic form of prayer, H. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embraced us as your children.
And welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ broken for you, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The body of Christ broken for you, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The blood of Christ shed for you, keep you in eternal life. So we say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. So the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. So go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.
my Saviour, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Vainly they watch his bed, Jesus, my Saviour.
Mighty triumph for his foes, he arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, alleluia, Christ arose. Death cannot keep him. My Savior, he tore the bars away, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. A victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever, he lives forever, he lives forever, he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose.